Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the panel called the SME panel, organized on behalf of the joint event. Can you hear it? You cannot hear it? That's white noise. Well, calm theory, what do you expect? As long as it doesn't fade, we're all right. I just want to say that before we even start, my name is Andreas Polydoros and I'm chairing this panel. I would like to point out that this is a very experimental event for our community. This is a research community, and this is probably the first time in the 12 years that we've been dealing with NEWCOM, at least, that we have a panel that is mixing questions of research with business. So it will have an experimental flavor, and that's just to excuse us for any slips. And also, the other novelty here is that we will be broadcasting this through WebEx to a good number of people remotely and companies who have expressed interest to attend it. So we're working out some synchronization problems in the process. So, but anyway, under all circumstances, I'd like to welcome you all and thank you for being here. I would like to extend my great thanks to my co-panelists who agreed to share the stage and share their opinions and wisdoms and experience. Mostly it's about experience in a different dimension. I would think that the research people here are, we're all research. I'm a researcher primarily. I'm still a professor. I pretend to be a businessman also, but I'm primarily a professor. This is another world. This is a different world. And I think it would be interesting to hear, to enter a different planet if you want, at least for an hour and a half. We have an hour and a half. We might extend a little bit more. I think there's a board meeting afterwards that we could possibly, you know, violate a little bit. But it depends on how it goes. We'll have a kind of a free flow. The plan I have in my mind for today is we'll spend about half an hour, no more, to hear individual presentations from our panelists. I've asked them to limit it 10 minutes or thereabouts. After that, we'll be more than happy to take questions from the floor as well as from the remote people. The people remotely can ask questions. We can't see them, but probably, hopefully, they can see us and hear what we have to say. And at about an hour from now, I will have one interesting story from NEWCOM, which I'd like to have them present their thoughts. I'll introduce it at that time. It's kind of a little surprise. And possibly some other variation that I'll think along the way. And with that short introduction, I'd like to, so we're gonna just distribute this and distribute this. That's how it goes. So this is the panel, NEWCOM, I should say the joint event with Cost Action, a panel about SMEs. And it's happening today. So let me just, do you need the lights? Can you see? Are you okay? Actually, I need to see it myself. So let's just start with what the panel is all about. This is an activity. It's called the dissemination activity. It's one of the contractual obligations that NEWCOM has. And the organizers here, Carlson, Marco, and Narcis, got a good idea of putting together a panel. The idea is to connect with small and medium enterprises, size enterprises. And there's many questions related to that. What exactly do we mean by that? So I just listed here a rather ambitious list of things that could be addressed. And here are some of them. I've asked my co-panelists to take a cut at it. So for instance, can high-level research in wireless communications feed new startups? If yes, what are some of the currently hot topics and themes that could convert themselves to business? Do you go about developing original intellectual property, or are you building on applications or services that exist on existing standards so that you have an easier entry? What matters mostly? Is it technology that matters, or something else, or the other? And if it's the other, what is it? Is it the opportunity, timing, funding that you found, and so on? Is it the human resources, the talent that you've managed to gather together, the management? What is it? Or is it the plan? Is it a tight, very well-crafted business plan and its execution, or is it the flexibility of that business plan? And basically, what does it take to make it in the small business world? And something relevant, of course, to NEWCOM, how do we encourage younger researchers to make the jump, to try it, from research to entrepreneurship? These are the questions that will be addressed by my great co-panelists here, and I'd like to introduce them. I'd like to take 2 minutes to introduce them before they go on and talk. First of all, we're very pleased to have Professor Andrea Goldsmith, came all the way from California. She's a professor at Stanford. All of you who listened to her great presentation, the plenary, know that detail. She's suited for this panel because she has studied two. Quantenna Communications, and I happen to know the CEO because he was at USC, right. Sam Haidari, and Wildfire Exchange. I'm sure you get the spirit of what this is about through her plenary, but you'll hear more about it. Then we have, I'll take liberties with the names, I hope I pronounce them right, Yves Lostanlen, close enough? Okay. He's the CEO of Sierra Dell North America in Canada, and he also teaches part-time, I guess. He's an adjunct professor at the University of Toronto. Sits right next to Andrea. Then we have Mark Almendros, who is the president and CEO of Signadan here in Spain. We're pleased to have people local here who could join us. And then we have Oscar Carrasco, who is the chief technical officer of Sistel Banda in Spain. So we have a representation of small, not only academics, we have a representation of small businesses, and we're very pleased and very honored to have that. And of course, myself. So without much ado, I'll just start my presentation. My name is Andreas Polidoros. I work now for the University of Athens. I used to work for the University of Southern California in Los Angeles for very many years, and then I crossed the pond, as they say. But before I left from California to Athens, Greece, I co-founded a company, the name of which is Trellisware Technologies, and it's housed in San Diego. It's in the wireless valley, not the Silicon Valley, the wireless valley, which is what Qualcomm started in San Diego, as everybody knows. So quickly about me, I got educated in Athens, and my doctorate is actually from USA, where I started my professional career as an educator. I was a professor there until the end of the 90s, and then I moved to Athens. And as I said, before I left, I co-founded Trellisware Technologies, and I'm currently the chair of its technical advisory board. We review programs and so on. It's a privately held company. It's a fabless manufacturer of telecom products. Its main current market is the United States government, and its main current product is Manet networks and radios. It has a Manet system that it sells. Interestingly, it has a very strong emphasis on proprietary intellectual property. Another way of saying that is we prepare the solutions from scratch, we design the solutions, and we manufacture the solutions, and we sell the product, and we support the product. We're vertically integrated from the algorithm all the way to the thing out of the door. And it has been co-founded by two industrialists, Tom Carter, also a PhD from USA, is the CEO, and Mark Johnson is the chief engineer, and two academics, myself and Keith Chagg, who is also now a professor at USC. If you ask what were the technological foundations of this company, I would say advanced coding. In fact, you know, advanced turbo codes and turbo equalization and radio engineering in general. And there is a motto on the front page, and the motto is when nothing else works, which basically puts it in perspective. It says, we're going to look at scenarios where ordinary solutions would not do. If you can do it with LTE, don't call us up. If you can do it with Wi-Fi, don't call us up. But if you can't do it with those, then we might be able to do something for you. And you can imagine that our kinds of customers do find themselves in such situations. So here's my take, my quick take on the questions I posed. Can high-level research feed the new startup? Absolutely. That's my personal experience. That's what Trellisware did. It relied on what was developed prior to starting it and subsequently doing it real time. What are some of the currently hot topics? I think the two plenary presentations kind of position that very well. Dense and complex networks and the radio access and RRM problem. pushing the envelope on robustness and throughput, and doing it such that you are competitive at the swap, meaning the size, weight, power, and cost. You have to be power efficient and so forth. How about developing original IP, or just, you know, use existing standards like Wi-Fi and build a business on a Wi-Fi chip, for instance? I would say either way. It's easier if you start with an existing standard. It's there. It's cheaper. You don't have to worry about that. There might be less barriers to entry, though, because other people can do it also. We did it from the original IP standpoint, but I'm sure many other successful businesses start with existing standards and build up. So what matters? Well, we're technologists, so we might want to think that technology is what matters, but I would say at least as much is the other side of the equation. Technology is a sine qua non, is necessary, but I learned the hard way that there's a lot of other things, and you have to be lucky. Make sure you're lucky. Work hard at being lucky. So we have his philosophy. It's not my philosophy, it's the CEO's philosophy, and he's put it as follows. He says, put an exceptional team of people, of researchers, of engineers together. Make sure to keep the lights on. Cash flow is king. Make sure that your operation is going, basically. You don't go under. It's very critical. And eventually, yeah, good things will happen. And I can attest to that. That's what happened to Trellisware. So how about the plan? I think it also varies. Some people like focused plans so that they execute very tightly. And some other people like Trellisware a little bit more flexible. And you go with the punches and so on. You can tell that either one has pluses and minuses, and there's no one answer, in my opinion. Depends on the circumstance. Make sure you're lucky. What does it take to make it? You have to be you have to persevere. As I said, Thomas Edison said that before me, right? 99% perspiration and so on, but it's true. You just have to hang in there for the longest time, basically. And how do you encourage young researchers? You know, I've obviously worked in academia, I've worked in NEWCOM for so many years, and I can tell it's how difficult it is to get out of your comfort zone. You're a researcher, you want to solve problems. You want a nice model? Go at it, right? Write your papers and move on. So it's difficult, I understand that, but it's something that's very exciting. Business is fun. I have learned tremendous amounts of things in the business world. I'm mostly as a student, I mean, I contributed a little, but I mostly learned how these people work, and it's just amazing. Very great fun. Very scary, I live by the day, but it's great fun. It's a different world, very different from academia, so, but it's your chance to grow personally in other dimensions that you didn't have before. You can test your research, here's this, you can test your research in the real world and see if it makes a difference, you know? Most papers won't tell you that. You don't know if it really works until you go out there and try it. So it makes it's an opportunity, business opportunity, to see whether you really have something or not. It's less protected than academia, obviously, so you have to develop an appetite for risk. Yeah. So my corollary is that in business, many times, failure is success. And that I mean, when you fail and fail again, you learn the lessons, stand up again, and try again. It's not your usual model in research, because in PhD, you know, you only have one shot, right? You work for 4 or 5 years, and you better get it. I don't know many people who try it 3 times in PhD. So in research, we use that somehow. But usually, you do your research in 4 or 5 years, and you know, you get there. In business, it's different, because it's risky. You have to be willing to try and fail and try again, basically. And what I thought is, why is it so hard? Because I see it's hard. Young researchers don't really many times want to try something like that. And I think we need to invent someday a soft transition. We need to find a way where there's an apprenticeship in the SME creation world. You know, people try that and see what they like without risking their other careers. You know, we have to someday invent these mechanisms that make this transition, even as a testing way, easier. And people that way will know what they're really meant for. And with that, really, I'll end my short presentation. And we're not going to take any questions now. We're going to go through the panels first, and then we'll take collective questions from the audience. And
okay. Can someone bring up my slides, or should I? But I don't know how to. Well, it's a pleasure to be here. This is going to be very different from my plenary talk. And basically, in order to answer Andreas's questions, I decided I would tell my professional story, including my two startups, and answer the questions along the way. So I started professionally getting my undergraduate degree in 1986 from Berkeley, and from there I did my first startup. I was a member of the technical staff in a defense communications company in 1986 to 1989. That's me with an antenna array, so I was actually doing MIMO before it was cool. And this is actually, this picture is in the middle of Santa Clara, so those of you that have been in Santa Clara recently know there's not any blank fields or empty spaces like there was back in the 80s. So it's a very different time in Silicon Valley than in the bubble days or even today. So working in the startup, which was actually a very poorly run startup, I learned a lot of lessons about what not to do. But one good thing about the startup was that it was all PhDs and new bachelor graduates from good schools. And working with the PhDs, they thought about problems differently than me, and they were able to solve things that I couldn't even imagine solving. And that actually motivated me to go back for my PhD. So I went back to Berkeley. I've been told to tell the remote participants to mute their microphones, please. Okay, so I went back to Berkeley to get my PhD. The Maxim was a defense communications company. We were working on satellite communications as well as direction finding with MIMO, and I wanted to continue working in wireless, but I wanted to move into more commercial wireless, and particularly was interested in cellular systems, so that's what I ended up doing my doctoral research in. I worked at Bell Labs for a couple summers during that time. And then finished in 94, I looked around at industry jobs, research labs, and academic jobs, and I ended up going to Caltech. So that's where I started my faculty career. And I was there for 4 years, and then I moved to Stanford in 99, right at the height of the bubble days, and I have good stories about students coming into my office at Stanford saying, why are you a professor? You could make millions of dollars doing a startup company, or I've got a great idea, will you sign an NDA before I can tell you about it? It was a really crazy time in Silicon Valley. But I was happy to stay as a professor. I've actually been involved in four startups. I've been involved in two. The second startup I was involved in was a company called Merrill, that's still around, building proprietary 5-inch radios for long-distance communication. And they were based in Wisconsin, and how I got involved in that was another startup that I won't spend time on. But it was the big lesson I learned from that company was don't build a proprietary radio standard, because it's not likely to be very successful. So that was the Memory Link story. And then I went on to do my first company, which I would say is founding a company from scratch, and that was Quantenna, which I mentioned in my plenary. We actually founded Quantenna to build very low power Wi-Fi for cell phones, but quickly found out, because we had a very prominent VC lead investor who got us into Apple, who told us, we're never going to put your chips in our phones, because why would a company like Apple risk betting on a startup for their Wi-Fi chip? So we pivoted completely, going back to the question of should you have a plan. You should have a plan, but you should be prepared to completely throw it out the window when you realize that it's a bad plan. And this happens all the time in startups. So you have to be flexible. So we pivoted to do something completely different, which was the best performance Wi-Fi. I mentioned that they just announced 10 gigabit per second Wi-Fi, which is the, actually Quantenna has been the performance leader in terms of data rates from the beginning. That's what we set out to do. And we had the first 4x4 MIMO system, and now we have the highest data rate have since our first product. Now, one of the interesting things about Quantenna is it's a chip company, which is a very expensive endeavor. So Quantenna's raised $80 million in funding. That's not a game, that's my stock is coming out early as much as the guys that did bits or even Snapchat, because they can be so much money. So if you're going to do a real hardware company, it takes a lot of money, which means that you're likely running out of money many, many times in the course of the company, and Quantenna certainly was very close to running out of money many times. Now, though, it's quite successful. So they're almost break even, which is basically means they could go public or they could get bought, and their exit strategy, you know, remains to be seen. But definitely I would consider today Quantenna as a successful company. It has lots of customers. It's selling on the order of $100 million a year. So it's really a success. But it was not a smooth journey, and I'll talk about that more as I go on. And it was not apparent that it was going to be successful over many, many times. So I went back to Stanford in 2009. And then in 2010, founded another company. Now you might say, why would you be crazy enough to found another company right away? And the reason was that this company was built to do the SON for Wi-Fi and the software-defined wireless networking vision. And I just felt like this was something that could change the industry, and how could I turn down the opportunity to do a company that might change my industry? Now, that company has also been through a lot of ups and downs. They've raised $20 million in funding and are raising more. Both these companies are on their third CEO. So there's been a lot of turmoil in both companies along the way. So that's my journey. I've also been on the technical advisory board to a number of companies, and I've also learned a lot about technology and startups and business through those three companies. So going to the question of why I did a startup, and I'm talking about Quantenna now, why did I take a leave of absence from Stanford to found a company? Just addressing Andreas's point about a soft transition, actually as an academic, you have a much easier, much lower risk in doing a startup than everybody else that's joining you, because they don't have a fallback job. They can't go back from sabbatical to their nice, cushy academic job. And by the way, everybody knows that. So you are in a slightly different category as a founder who's an academic, because everybody knows you have a backup plan when they don't. And this affects how you're treated as a founder, how you're treated as an executive in the company. Now, why did I do a startup? It was not to make money, even though I like money, I like good wines and traveling and all this, but that wasn't my motivation for doing a startup, in part because in the 80s when I was in Silicon Valley, I saw most startups go under. So it's not, you have to realize that doing a startup, the chances of you being successful is very low. And if you go into it with that attitude and you go into it for other reasons and then you make money, that's great. But if you don't make money, you don't feel like you were a failure or that you wasted your time. So I didn't go into it to make money. I did it to build something. So going back to my journey, 1986 at Maxim was the last time I had built something. And then I went back to grad school, and I spent 20 years doing lots of theory, lots of information theory, lots of communication theory, writing lots of papers. I wanted to build something, which was the first Quantenna chip shown here, and basically see, does theory matter? Does all this work that I've been doing over the last 20 years, writing papers and so on and so forth, does it have an impact on technology? And one of the most gratifying things when I started going to the Wi-Fi standards meetings, because academics don't go to standards meetings, is I thought, well, I won't know anybody there. They all know me, they all know you, they all read our papers, and they implement our ideas in technology. So that was very gratifying. I would have done the startup just to learn that we actually have more impact on technology than we know, because the people in industry are reading our papers and learning from what we do. The other reason I did the startup was to say, okay, now I'm going to go build something. I'm going to see if technology matters. What am I going to learn about building something that I can bring back to my research and teaching? And I have to say that many of the research topics I've worked on since I came back from Quantenna, low-power radios, sub-Nyquist A to D converters, many other things came out of what I learned from building hardware and saying, you know, analog matters, complexity matters, energy consumption. I mean, all these things are really important when you go build a system. So what were the lessons that I learned from Quantenna? First one is that academics have great jobs. I mean, it's so easy to be an academic compared to being an entrepreneur. It was a rough road. I have to say, I can point directly to the day and time of the worst moment of my career, which was in Quantenna. So, you know, there's, and I'll talk about that in a moment. So it's a tough road. You have to be prepared for hard knocks. It's not an easy path to be an entrepreneur. The other thing, which I already alluded to, is that the theory that we do has a huge impact on wireless system design, especially at the physical layer and also somewhat at the Mac layer, not so much above it. So all of our game theoretic networking and cross-layer design, these things have not yet had a huge impact on the technology, the networking technology that we build. It's more the people in computer science that have influenced networking, not so much the common information theorists. I already mentioned also that, this was also an interesting lesson. So the first time I realized what the price of our chip was going to be, which was about $5, cost of a Starbucks latte, I'm like, that's 30 years of communication theory is $5. You know, I mean, that's really, you know, where's the value? Yeah, you sell a lot, but still, I mean, that was surprising to me that, you know, we have to put incredibly sophisticated technology into these physical layer technologies, and we don't necessarily get that much out of it. You can sell an app for a dollar that has a lot less technology than what's in one of these Wi-Fi chips. The next lesson was that, right, there's my chip and equals a Starbucks coffee. In wireless design, analog matters. So again, I do comm and information theory. That's all digital. I never thought about what happens before the A to D converter. But so much about what happens in a real wireless system is what happens before the A to D converter. So it behooves us to understand more about analog signal processing. And again, that's why I started working on sampling and A to D converters, because actually technology evolution in A to D's and in analog happens way slower. Moore's law is only after the A to D. Okay, analog components do not scale in either A to D converters at the same rate as digital components do. Complexity drives cost, size, and energy consumption. So one of the challenges that Quantenna had is we were, you know, shooting to be the best performance on the market, which means, you know, the most number of antennas, the most sophisticated coding, the most sophisticated modulation, and that meant our chip was bigger and used more energy, and we had to work very hard to get it down to be this $5 chip because it wasn't competitive at a higher price, even though we had better performance. So many customers won't pay $1 more for better performance, or even 50 cents more. So you have to make sure that that better performance is built into your system in a way that keeps it price competitive. And the last lesson, so startups are hard. They're really hard. Like I said, the worst moment in Quantenna was when I was edged out by my co-founder, CEO. Okay, so the team is really key. Who you found the company with, who your CEO is, because they are really the boss. As academics, we don't have bosses. It was a big adjustment to me to realize, okay, the CEO calls the shots no matter what. And some luck is needed, but you need a lot more than luck. And sometimes you don't need luck. So let me go on to some of my other lessons. Co-founders usually make or break a company. If you look at any successful company, any successful startup, most of the time, the co-founding team is still there many, many years later. So having a good team of co-founders is really important. It establishes the vision, the culture, and the framework for success. Ideally, co-founders are not your friends because you can't fire your friends. The best co-founders are people you've worked with before and you know. After that are strangers, people that you haven't worked with before. That's better than friends and family because of many dynamics that exist with friends and family. And then the other interesting thing is that the role of founders change over time, and that doesn't always work. Either founders are no longer suited for the role that they have. Both founder CEOs in my two startups were booted out by the boards. So you have to know that even if you're founding a company with the right people, that their roles may change and they may actually no longer be appropriate people in the company anymore, and that can be very painful. Building the team beyond the founders is also extremely important because you want to maintain the culture and you want to maintain the same vision. And the early investors have a profound impact. In part because they fund you. If you run out of money, you're dead. The most important thing is keeping the lights on, no question about it. But and your early investors not only provide the money to begin with, but also subsequent rounds, they bring in other investors. So that they can also make connections, like Sequoia connected us to Apple and the iPhone, Tony Fadell. But they also make decisions that fundamentally change the company, like they fire the CEO. So in both of my two startups, the CEO was booted out. In the first case, it was a good thing. In the second case, the second CEOs that came in were not good, and they were both eventually replaced. And so both my startups are on their third CEO. So the board, that's the most important thing they do, is they fund you, they keep the lights on, and they control who is the leader of the company. And I will reiterate, the CEO makes all the decisions. That is the boss. And so if the board is controlling who the CEO is, the board is controlling the destiny of the company, if they have more than 50% ownership. Okay, so the biggest lesson is that research has a lot of impact on IT. So going back to the question of can research lead to technology that can lead to startups? Absolutely. And it's not just in wireless. It's in converting the analog world to bits, A to D sampling, quantization. These technologies have lacked innovation for a long time. There's a lot of room for innovation there. Related to that is compression and storage. Data processing and big data, there's certainly been a lot of investments in that. And then the cloud is another hot topic that has been influenced by research in both computer science and communication. So what are the hot topics? Oh, so I also, just to make sure it's clear, research will influence technology in the future. It has a huge impact because a lot of the innovation comes out of research. So what are the hot topics for startups? Okay, so carrier plays dead in the water if you go to a VC in Silicon Valley. You say you're going to build a business around selling to carriers, it's pretty hard to get in the door. Standards, you're going to build a new waveform for 5G, forget about getting funding. Nobody will believe that you can possibly make that happen. And the worst is hardware. So Quantenna could possibly be the last startup, especially chips. Why? Remember I said $180 million. That's a big bet for many investors to make before they're going to know if it's going to be successful. For a long time, apps and social media were the rage. That's fading. Before that, there was clean tech and biotech. That's fading. And the VC industry, at least in Silicon Valley, is very much in turmoil. There have not nearly been as many exits of startups as in the past. That means that VCs are having a hard time raising funds, and when they raise funds, there's less money, which means they're shedding partners and closing down. It's the most tumultuous time I've ever seen in the Valley, and I've been in the Valley since the 80s. And then there's all these super angels, which are basically super rich people that decide they're going to invest in companies, and they're competing with the traditional VCs for the early stage funding. So it's a very tumultuous time. And so the bottom line, in my opinion, is that nothing is really hot. There's no way to say, okay, if I do a company in technology X, I'm going to get funded or it's going to be successful. So you have to be smarter about what should you build your startup around. And I think in some ways the Valley and VCs and investors are going back to the basics to say you need strong teams. That's the most important thing that VCs look for. You need differentiating technology or services. So it's not enough to be the next, you know, Snapchat or the next Flux. You need something differentiating. And you need a credible monetization strategy to say, okay, well, we're going to get 10 billion people using our service for free. That's probably not going to get you funded these days. Okay, so let me, this is, I think, my last slide. The most important one. Should a young researcher do a startup? So first, ask yourself the following questions. And by the way, there's a great book called The Founder's Dilemma, which anyone who's thinking of doing a startup or is doing a startup or has done a startup should read, because it talks about all the questions you will encounter along the way of doing a startup and how they have been gotten wrong by so many people, so you can learn from their mistakes. So you have to answer the following questions as yes. Are you passionate about turning an idea into a technology and then a company? And those are not the same things. Research is not technology. Technology is not a product, and a product is not a company. So you need to be able to follow that whole path and be passionate about it. If not, stay as an academic or a researcher, because it's a much easier path. Do you want to or can you go solo? I've never wanted to do a company as a sole founder. I'm a team person. But if you do form a team, and I've always felt like I needed complementary expertise to what I'm doing, then you better find good founding partners, and that is an extremely important thing. I made some mistakes in startup number one in terms of my co-founders. I did not make those same mistakes the second time around. I made other mistakes. So, you know, it's very difficult to find the right founders. Are you prepared for the trials and tribulations of a startup? It is a rough ride. There's many ups and downs. It's not at all like the cushy job of academia, where the worst thing is you don't get tenure. I mean, you know, getting edged out by your founder, seeing the team that you brought into this company that believed in you let go because you're out of money. I mean, there's many emotional things that go on as a founder that you will never encounter in the academic world. And then you should look at your career and family. I mean, is this something that for your career, is this the right time to do a startup? Is it, you know, if you're pre-tenure and you want to stay as an academic, I would not recommend doing a startup. And it takes a lot of time away from other things, including your family. All of that said, and despite all the trials and tribulations that I've been through in two startups, and there's a lot, it can be both the most challenging and the most rewarding adventure of your career. I would not have done, even knowing what I know now, I might have done things differently, but going back to when I founded my first company and my second company, I learned so much, I got so much out of it, it was tough, but I would do it again in a heartbeat. So I'll end with that.
Sure, sir. Thank you. Do we have to remind that the remote participants should turn off their microphones? Yeah. Ready to go. Okay, thank you. So I will start a little bit about an introduction to who I am. Some of you don't know me. It's a real pleasure to be part of this panel and to see again so many known faces. I'm the CEO of Ciradel North America, and I'm the wellness CTO of the Ciradel Group. Ciradel is a French company headquartered in Brittany, so I've started actually working in the company in France, and I've moved to North America, to Toronto, 7 years ago. And I'm also an adjunct professor at University of Toronto, so I didn't manage to quit fully the academia. So I've started my master's in France and Germany, then prepared my PhD in London in the UK and in France. Then I've done an habilitation, and then an executive MBA at MIT in Boston. I've worked for Ciradel, for academic institutions like the INSA, National Institute for Applied Sciences in Rennes, for Capgemini, Ernst & Young, and for Siemens. And over the past 15 years, I've worked quite a lot for the telcos, so in Europe, Asia, and North America, and for the equipment vendors. And among the various management experiences that I had, so startups, subsidiaries, business units, and collaborative projects, Ciradel was lucky enough to be part of 8 research projects funded by the European Commission, so with some of you, and it's always a great pleasure to be part of this kind of ecosystem. So what does Ciradel do? So we're in the field of ICT and digital media. That's an independent company, created in 94, and the company started in diffraction, electromagnetism radar. And so I joined the company getting rid of a tenure track, actually. I entered in the company in 2001, in September, the 3rd September 2001. A month later, the company filed for Chapter 11. So I still hope there was no correlation between those two facts. But that was the first very interesting experience in our business plan. They didn't work quite well. And our hardware versus software. And the first pivoting experience for the company. So then we decided to focus more on the software and consulting, and then data. We're also in Toronto, as I said, in China, and now we have more than 200 customers. We have two main activities. The first one is actually what we call empowering wireless networks. So we are helping the telcos basically to optimize their network over the various generation of cellular systems. We are pretty strong in the propagation modeling, and guess what? Wireless starts with some sense of the wireless channel. And we also have come up with wireless channel models that helps actually, that's the distinction between propagation modeling for the radio coverage, etc., and the channel modeling that are used actually by the equipment vendors to design the algorithms, to enhance the algorithms, and for the standards as well. Second activity is the smart city planning. And so for that, we actually produce 3D GIS data. You know, it's very popular now with Google Earth, but we are producing that ourselves. Some of the data you see in Google Earth come from Citadel, actually. But those data are very well used by the telecommunication operators in order to get a sense of the coverage. So we have one of the leading database in the world, the top 100 cities in North America, for example, that were covered last year. And we also edit complex big data and focusing on the user experience design. And that's actually really this ramping up activity at Citadel, the smart city planning. That's obviously start with their connectivity, and then you build various applications. So we have software, big data and GIS data, and services. We work on 4G, Internet of Things, 5G and beyond, connected cities, object and people. And I will elaborate slightly on that later on. So those tools are actually for the engineers and the data as well. So here you see a coverage in Dubai, multi-floor. That's very important to have a good sense of the multi-floor coverage in Dubai on the left. Oh, that's very kind of you. In the middle, you have an example of the smart city monitoring. So then in the smart city, we cross georeference data with any kind of data that could be collected through sensors, that could be predicted, that could be, you know, obtained thanks to statistic databases. So we do that in our 3D software. And those tools are also used for the strategic decisions in order to prepare the customer experience management and to help the strategic groups in the telcos and the equipment vendors to identify the various opportunities when they have to deal with all those hypes or not hype type of data. So the interesting thing for the panel that we may want to remind is that Andreas asked us to prepare those questions, but we haven't shared anything, so that was in a total independent way. And the idea is also to see if there is a pattern there, if there are some, you know, frequency of apparition of some words or notions. So can high-level research in wireless communications feed new startups? That's for sure. Creating and capturing economic value and social benefits are very important, and it may start with the technology. Yes, but it should be done probably part of an ecosystem, not try to reinvent an ecosystem or standard. It's really taking the steep way, and most probably you won't be funded. And we have to be careful also with this ambitious platform offering. So platform in software, everybody wants to do a platform. Say everybody will build apps on my platform. That's extremely ambitious. The business models are not clear. The software as a service have very hard time to be successful. So in the wireless industry, how to manage that, because we are getting there, is interesting, I think. The IP licensing might be a challenge with some universities. With some of them, that's very easy. The IP belongs to the professor, and that's it. The professor can build the startup and create a good team, etc. For some others, the IP belongs to the university, and then you have to deal with those technology transfer bureaus that come all over the places, and sometimes it works well, sometimes that's a real challenge. And the IP to be traded between companies when they are small are also an interesting challenge, not to mention a small startup and a large company. And the path, indeed, from the research results to operational product and services is sometimes very long, certainly not straight. If it's straight, that's extremely steep, and there is a difference between a product, service, and a company. So what are the some currently hot topics, themes? Well, I will see that by the prism of what we are doing in North America and in Europe, basically what people ask us to research on. The first topic is certainly the combination of diverse application. We see that for the 5G, going from the low power, wide area type of applications, IoT if you'd like, to the high throughput 5G small cells, possibly in the millimeter wave. You have to deal with license and unlicensed, so a bunch of various systems to deal with, and we still look for solutions to do that in a more personal manner. Sharing robust infrastructures. I've mentioned smart cities, and the difficulty is that for smart cities, the connectivity is taken for granted. So they consider that it works, and we all know that it's not always the case. Focusing on those urbanized areas is certainly important. That's where the most of the traffic is present. But as Ravir mentioned in his keynote, for some applications like transportation, vehicular technologies, you need also a very large coverage, if not a full coverage of the areas. There is an increasing role of IT in our domain, let it be for cloud, virtual, control and coordinate. And we also have to adapt and to find the right vocabulary or the right way to discuss with those colleagues and possibly members of our companies. And data management, cognitive radio, how to access the spectrum locally through a system that is called Spectrum Access System, for example, currently a hot topic in the US. That's also very important. So IT is there, and wireless and IT need to work together, and we need to have those dual profiles. Geolocating, indoor, outdoor, more often in 3D now. And 3D also because we have moving radio links, D2D, V2V, drones, have a lot of requests for drones, links to drones, and elevated platforms. So even outdoor, that becomes 3D. And I think we've mentioned already the efficiencies in terms of energy, radiation, material, the property of the building, smart buildings that could adapt to various frequencies, either to shut off the frequencies or to let them go, and the efficiency of those three layers, 5, MAC, and IP. A lot of work to be done and to create value on those new systems. Maybe there is nothing new, but on those very well-known words, we still have a lot of work to do. We still need to collaborate on those. We still need money, basically, to research on that between academy and companies. Then developing original IP or build app services on existing standards. Well, it is probably somehow compatible. Being part of an ecosystem or possibly standards is far easier. There is no doubt about it. And being on the track of a larger company definitely helps pushing some ideas and building some parts of the standards. Then partnering is again the key to push the limits further, to have a holistic view of the problems. And again, when you're a startup or an SME, being able to be part of a European project of a network of excellence and so on is extremely important, to have a holistic view of those issues, to find the right expertise in the connects in the adjacent fields, that you're not able to do that internally in your company. But being a startup and collaborating for IP or to find the time to discuss is also quite a challenge. And my last slide is what matters, technology, thank you, or others. Well, technology, invention, and innovation matter, definitely. But successful companies will combine people, we've mentioned that, all of us, currently, markets, product, and services. And market is important. Market that indeed will my chip, will my software find potential users, and at what price? Is there really a market at the cost that I have to bear for this product, for this service? Among the people, because most probably we will be, you will be the technologists, you will need to find and to partner with good marketing people, marketing in the sense of strategy and in the sense of communication as well. And that's certainly something that in Europe we don't do very well. I'm still considering myself a European. I'm French, as you've heard. And so communication is extremely important. And at a very early stage, let it be to actually pitch to VCs or people we want to found, to be funded with, or just to their various partners of our ecosystem. Then the sales and the channels that will allow our product, our services to be sold are also important. And then the most obvious ones that seems to be easier or somehow easier for the technologies, the operations and the development. But the two first part are extremely important to have on board because most probably they will complement your skills, our skills, the best. Time to market, the agility. Let's understand as well that a product doesn't need, it's not like a theory, a product doesn't need to be perfect to be published or to enter a market, because then we have lots of opportunities to iterate or to do some pivoting, and let's pivot sooner than later. And then let's rely also on customer innovation. They will help actually defining the product and defining the workflow of this product. What does it take to make it? That's the other question. Well, willingness to make a difference, to build something, to solve real problems, and to create value. I will come back to this value notion in a couple of lines. Then tenacity, hard working and focus on the, a key part of what we want to do, and like-minded people around us to build the team. And again, I think that's a common trait, a common pattern of all those companies, like-minded people, not necessarily identical, but like-minded, sharing the same goals, and to build the team. How do we encourage younger researchers to make the jump from research to entrepreneurship? Well, sharing experiences and networking with companies and people like today. There is also LinkedIn, there are lots of cost actions and the like, network of excellence, that will help if we manage to bring the companies in, that will help actually, demystifying a little bit this this business part. And indeed, business is not necessarily a bad thing. And if really people can't do with money, that think that's a bad word, then you have the option to go for non-profit. That's also an option. And then the balance between invention and innovation. So innovation is not necessarily our technology. So maybe younger researchers want also to experience something else, that technology, see how it relates to a market, to something. The teamwork, the results are the sum of the combined contributions. That's also very important. Sometimes in the academia, we tend to have, a lonely journey among other people, like-minded as well, but the cooperation is not always straightforward. And experimentations, indeed, not only on the technology, but also on the user needs, understanding the users, understanding the market to make the difference. And successes are rewarding, failures are certainly learning experience, but how sweet are the rewards? And let's create and capture the values. I think that in those academic fields and conferences, we are extremely good at creating the value. Now let's try to find ways to capture the value. And maybe, indeed, those transitions from the academia to startups or small, medium enterprises are a good way to help on capturing the values. Thank you very much.
prefer to stand because
I can see the screen. So thank you very much. I would like to thank the organizers and mainly Andreas for inviting me to this panel. So I'm very proud of becoming part of this table because Signadine is not as big as all these other companies, these successful companies, but we are doing pretty well for the moment. So my name is Mark Almendros. I have a PhD. This is a different, let's say, a different story because I'm not purely from the telecom business. So I have a PhD in aerospace science and technology, doing quantum communications and quantum computation. And then Signaline is really a spin-off of this research. So we will see how. I also have an MBA in ESADE. So I'm going to start with an introduction of the company. So what we do at Signaline is basically test and measurement devices. So I'm talking about generators and digitizers. So we are in this ecosystem of Keysight, so formerly Agilent, National Instruments, and all these test and measurement companies. And we have, specialized in high performance and real time. So we have, for example, a very good implementation for FPGA programming, and also we have an exclusive technology for real time, to design real time sequences for testing, for example. So we are basically focused on the high end of the spectrum of the portfolio. So basically all high-end products. For example, we have the highest channel density arbitrary waveform generator in the market, so worldwide. And in fact, this arbitrary waveform generator is used by Agilent in one of their reference solutions to test LTE power amplifiers. So these are basically the two business lines of the company. One is test and measurement, so everything related to test, so automatic testing in, for example, in R&D, in production, in pre-production, quality control tests, hardware in the loop, I'm sure you know all these concepts, R&D instrumentation in general. And also we have another business line, which is embedded monitoring and control. So basically, all these, I haven't mentioned this, but all our equipment is basically modular. So we are working with mainly PXI Express. And this modular equipment is very suitable for embedded monitoring and control. So apart from purely test and measurement, we are talking about experimental control, for example. This is where we came from to control. You can use them for controlling small experiments or high energy physics experiments, like, for example, in a particle accelerator. To control industrial machinery, aerospace and defense codes, fast prototyping, and so on. So this is basically the two business lines of the company. As you can imagine, a test and measurement company is really a very general, in terms of market, you can address many markets. So not only telecom, but also science, industry, general electronics, energy, and so on. We are mainly focused on telecom, science, and all the semiconductors related to those markets. So I'm going to address the questions that Andreas proposed, and also how these questions were related to, for example, in this case, to Signaline. So the first one is, can high-level research feed new startups? I would say absolutely yes, but when one thinks about research, you can think about, for example, fundamental research, like the research that I was doing, and also more, practical research or more application-focused research. So even fundamental research can fit a new startup. Why? Because one, we have to think about the meaning of the word spin-off. And a spin-off can be really a thing that comes out from your main research focus, or it can be something collateral from this research focus, right? So in this case, for example, we went from an experiment which we're working with ion traps. So this is an ion trap for quantum telecommunication experiments. So this is a single trap ions. And this is what we were doing. So we end up from this, let's say, research to a test and measurement company. How? Well, basically because in this kind of experiments, you need control systems, which must be really high performance in terms of real time, in terms of speed, in terms of channel density, and so on. You basically control all this with RF. So that's why we are doing telecom now, with modulations, amplitude modulation, phase, frequency, and so on, IQ. And then we created an device to control this experiment. And from there, we started the company, and now we are doing basically test and measurement, generic test and measurement. Then another question was, if we should develop original IP or build application services on existing standards. So what I would say is, you have to, always when you have to take a decision, you have to ask yourself, is this development going to bring more value to the company? And if the answer is yes, then you have to do it. So, and what does value mean? Basically, value is the reason why customers buy your products, or it's also the reason why an acquirer buys your company. So if developing your own IP brings value to the company, then you should do it. If not, then you have to focus on the things that really bring value to the company. Why? Because development requires two things which are really scarce and are the main factors of a startup, which has basically time and resources, which means a lot of money, right? So we should not reinvent the wheel unless the standard wheels are not useful for our purposes. So basically, the takeaway for me is just develop something if it really provides a competitive advantage, which can be technological or can be a price advantage also. Maybe you say, I need to develop this IP because if not, I will not be competitive in price. This can be a good reason, for example. Or I need to develop this IP because I need to modify something to be competitive in terms of technology, for example. This can be another purpose. So what matters, technology or others? So under my modest opinion, I have summarized internal ingredients and external ingredients. So in terms of internal ingredients, I would say that you need a good technology or good products in general or good prices. Even if you have a good technology, I would agree with which has been said, you need good prices to compete in the markets nowadays. You need an outstanding team, of course. This had been also said before. And a clearly defined vision. Why? Basically because a vision allows you to define a mission, and a mission allows you to define a goal and a strategy and an action plan. And this, when I say clearly defined, it doesn't mean rigid. So it must be flexible. You need to move it. We have seen many cases where you have to change the strategy, where you have to move from one side to the other, but it must be clearly defined. Because if not, you cannot define an action plan, and if you don't define an action plan, then it's going to be difficult to success. And also external ingredients, right? One thing would be a big market. This is what a good venture capital will tell you. We need a big market because we want you to sell a lot. Then the right market situation, which means sometimes you find in some markets, you find, for example, situations in which there is a technology rupture or some particular competitive situation which would make you things much easier, right? And this is usually analyzed with a tool which is called the Porter 5 Forces. And it allows you to analyze, for example, the competitive forces, if there are new entrants, so in terms of products or technologies or substitutes of the technology and so on. And this tool allows you to see if the market is in the right situation to create an startup. So another question that comes really directly from this analysis is, can small companies, so sometimes they are called small monkeys, compete against big gorillas? And the answer is yes. I mean, it happens continuously. We have seen many examples here. And with the right technology and products, the right people, the right strategy, the right market situation, and with money, it can be done. I mean, we have seen many big companies which suffer from something which is called the innovator's dilemma. What is the innovator's dilemma? So basically, when you have a big company and you have a lot of revenue from a product family or from a from some technology, and you see that there is a substituting technology which is coming to the market, then you are suffering from a dilemma because you think, okay, if I develop products with this technology, because I'm the market leader, I will accelerate the change. So I will really affect my revenue because I will accelerate the change in the market to the new technology. So I, all my old products will start, the sales will start to go down. So I don't know what to do because I say, okay, because I'm the market leader, if I put a lot of money in this technology, then my sales will go down from all the other products. So I have to wait. But then while you wait, there are other players, of course, which can develop this technology and can affect your sales in long term. So this is called the innovator's dilemma. And we have seen many examples. So I've put here some of them. Kodak, BlackBerry, for example, they thought, okay, we are the market leaders in the company sector, for example, we have to do nothing. And in the meantime, you had Android, you had iPhones, you have many companies, no? So these situations, the market situations, are very good for startups. What does it take to make it? So basically, well, what I've said in the previous slide, plus a lot of money. This is really, and this has been said also. I don't know if you know this startup financing cycle, but basically, this graph tells you this is the revenue of the company, and this is time. So here there is a part which is called Valley of Death. That means that you have to develop the products or the technology, and you are just basically burning money. So you are just spending money, and you don't have sales because you don't have ready the technology or the products. So you need money to survive to this Valley of Death. And here where you might find the three Fs, so family, friends, and fools, business angels, public funding, for example, here in Europe, it can be easier to find public funding. For example, now with the Horizon 2020 and this kind of projects. And then also, of course, venture capital, well, business angels, and so on. It has been said also, hard work is going to be very hard. Really, there are a lot of moments which are really difficult when you know, I mean, when you have to think how to pay the salaries at the end of the month, and then you start getting nervous. And of course, a little bit of luck. Yeah. Sometimes you need some situations in the market or some things, which also you have to do the things in the right way, but you need also a bit of luck. How do we encourage entrepreneurship? So basically, I started the company. This also has been said because I like research. So I like designing things. And for me, designing a product or a technology is quite similar to designing a new company. So this is also why I started. And also, when it works, it's like when you have a product which works or you have a technology which works, it provides a lot of satisfaction. So this was basically my reason. Like in research, also fear is overcome by knowledge. So that means you have to learn about the tools. So most of the people that doesn't want to start a company because they don't know how to raise money, for example, to get money from venture capital. And so you have to know all this ecosystem. And this will allow you, maybe this will give you the needed push to do these kind of things. And also, I would recommend also to team up with some business people or to learn about business. In my case, for example, I did an MBA, but it's very good if you go to a business school and you team up with some young MBA guys. And another thing which has been said also is that entrepreneurs want to make money. Why? Basically because companies are about this, right? A company is thought to make money. If not, it's really a non-profit organization. So it's so basically this is everything. Thank you very much.
Hi all. My name is Oscar. I will try to say something that maybe is not new because I have a very good teams in the panel, but I will try to get my point of view. Okay. First of all, like most of us, I've been studying for many years, many things, maybe in a non-conventional way, because I was studying in parallel economics and telecom engineering. In fact, I was researching in both areas in parallel, researching both in financial markets, solving Black and Scholes equations for some Spanish banks, and as well doing my personal research on wireless network. In fact, this is my favorite research area, and that's the reason why I decided to follow that path. In that sense, I founded a company that is called Sistelbanda, and this company that I will try to summarize is making or trying to make 4G small cells. So I hope I'm not. Andrea is some. Is not really having all. Let's say we will have some room for deploying our small cells. In any case, we're a Spanish SME. We're more or less 43 people. Most of us are PhDs or MSCs or BSCs in telecom and. information science engineering, and we're trying to delivering end-to-end small cell networks. We started also trying to deliver only software, but like some of my mates have said, we had to change our mind because operators do not think the way we thought initially. So we were forced to make some changes in our initial business plan. We were forced to make some deals with some chipset manufacturers. This was really, really hard because you are just like nothing. If you cannot sell, let's say, 1 million chips of their products, you're have small changes to work with those guys, but if you have the chance to demonstrate some of your things, some of the things you're delivering, you can have also the opportunity of building something different. In that sense, what was our tagline or our motto was software in networks, and our company was mostly founded with help of the Polytechnic University of Valencia and the Mobile Communication Research Group, because most of the people who is working in Sistelbanda come from here. We have a strong relationship, a strong collaboration with them, and it has been one of our key. Our key contributors to the ideas that we have developed here. So first of all, I think that research, if you're making technology, is a must. It's not the only component of the mix, but should be present. Otherwise, you cannot offer anything different. In following with my company, it's curious because we managed to present a research project in the H 2020 last call, and we are the coordinators of one of the 18 research projects of the 5G BPPP Association that is mainly addressing dynamic spectrum access networks with small cells in licensed and unlicensed bands. So we are mainly focusing on of delivering multi-access networks layer 2 and layer 3 solutions, and we are trying to combine all the current radio access technology, combining into a homogeneous and coherent system. Okay, in terms of products, what we will deliver? I was changing. What we are delivering. We are delivering an end-to-end small cell network. We are delivering all the components that an operator needs in order to deploy a complete service using 4G only right now. But we aim to combine different radio access technology in the arising 5G world, because we know that 5G, we still don't know what it will be, but we are convinced that it will make a seamless, or it will provide a seamless coordination of all radio access technologies that we currently have. So we are mostly interested on all the use cases that my colleagues have said, massive IoT, that kind of ultra broadband access network that allows to multiply by a factor of 1,000 the current network performance. So we are trying to address all these things by means of also developing all the software components that runs in every network entity of a small cell network. We are not doing anything related with the EPC, with the network core, but we are doing the rest of the thing. We're competing with giants, with people that is making great things, but we still think that we have something to add to this world, and we're trying to deliver something different. So that's the reason why we are here. Okay, and regarding the questions that Andreas has made to the panels, I'm truly convinced that research can feed new startups. In fact, I think that almost all the most successful companies in the world, you can see, starting from Qualcomm, ending from at Quantenna, or even other companies like Google, have started from a research activity. Maybe are other companies that are really successful, like Facebook, that are not based on the kind of research we do, but there's a lot of work and a lot of research behind that companies. So we can always find links between academia and research. In fact, we founded the company after having and after getting a research grant. So I can say that in our case, and this is a complete truth. What are the hot topics or themes we are addressing? We are currently working on ultra dense networks, mainly for trying to use LTE small cells in what we call virtual cell clusters, or that is another way to define a distributed massive MIMO system. And we are working as well in cloud-based hybrid zone solutions for 4G and 5G. And we are working as well in LTE LLA, providing carrier aggregation over the licensed spectrum. Are we delivering original IP, or our services are based in standards? As most of my colleagues have said, we are delivering some original IP, but we're strongly based on international standards, because otherwise you cannot work, or you cannot address all the people that can potentially use your technology. In fact, if you are not compliant to your competitors, you are losing some of your market. In fact, you cannot enter in where your competitors are. So in that sense, we are more or less forced to use international standards, but only using standards is not enough. So you need to add some spice, something different, some of your research in order to provide something new that can be either in your product or in your business model. But if having an original view of the world is a must for founding a company. At least this is my idea. Regarding what matters, technology is a must, but there are other things that are also a must. In fact, if you don't have a business plan, you don't have a business. So, in fact, many incredible technologies just dead because the market was not still ready, the business model was not properly defined, and they didn't take into account that innovation is equal to invention plus commercialization. So you should always look to your customers, because at the end of the day, they will pay your research, they will pay all your team, and they will support the life of your company. So the other, or all the other companies are mandatory in order to deliver a successful company. If we talk about the team, I can tell you that the team is maybe 90% of your company. These stories about great men that are just fighting alone against an incredible army that, in my understanding, are just story tales that are not linked with the reality. There are some people that can manage that, but are, let's say, less than 100% of the successful companies are founded by only one person. So the team is really, really important. In fact, team choices are shape strategic choices of your company. So it's critical building a great team for developing a technology and also for developing the culture of your company. Some key considerations, passion, values, heterogeneity, size, skills, should be analyzed and should be deeply think in order to build your team. It will help you to survive and to succeed, or it will bring you to your company death. And what about the plan? That's also a really, really important thing. You should be flexible, but you need to have a plan. Otherwise, it's like a great chess master said one time, it's better to have a bad plan than having no plan. Because if you have no plan, you cannot react in any sense. So you cannot take decisions without a solid background. And your team will help on taking those decisions, even for changing the plan if it's needed. And I think it's more or less my last slide. And what does make does it take to make it? Maybe this is the most difficult question to address. Having luck is also very important. Otherwise, is almost impossible, because there are what does it take to make it? If you don't have a luck, and it's really, really hard to succeed in this world. But there are other elements that should be present together in the mix for making a successful company. In any case, having passion, motivation, talent, and a great team are the key enablers, in my opinion, for making a world-class technological company. And finally, how do we encourage researchers to make the jump from to enter to entrepreneurship? This is for Europe. I think this is a key question to address, because jumping from the research to the industry or the business space is always a challenge. You are going outside of the place where you are good, where you don't have problems, where you are stability. So you need to take some risks, and there are not always risks in terms of the money you can earn in one place or on another, but there are other kind of things you will need to analyze. And afterwards, there's a great reward if you can deal to found a company, because you are facing also other kind of problems. You are facing human being problems. You are analyzing how the people will react when you will show your ideas, when you will show your project. You will need to convince not only to your customers, but also the people who is financing your company, and many people that are involved in one project. If you are making a small app, let's say if you are making just application for Android, maybe this is not the things you must analyze. But if we are making wireless communication systems, if we are making those kinds of things, we should for sure think on that. In any case, I think that we may think in great things in order to achieve the smaller ones, as the technology world is global, and we should try to go everywhere with our technology. Thank you.
I'll let first of all, I'll let everybody think through what you heard, so you can think of the commonalities or the differences. As I said, it was done spontaneously. Everybody had their own opinions. What I would like to do is point out a few things. First of all, let me just say that we've been given permission by the authorities here, Carl Santon being the authority, to continue with the panel. There was another obligation that was that happened earlier at the board and so on. So we have time. That's a good news. What I think I would like to do is field. Get some excitement into the system. We're going to field some questions, and the panel will take turns in answering those. I'd like to give priority to the remote people. So if people remotely have any questions, please go ahead, raise your hand electronically, and you'll be directed here. And then we'll field some questions internally. What I'd like to do is take about 20 minutes maybe, questions, and then we're going to have a presentation, another short presentation from within NEWCOM that actually it's interesting. It's about a platform. I heard an interesting comment here, really. So, and that will conclude it. But before we move on, I would be very amiss if I didn't acknowledge the great help of Danilo Abrigani. He's a PhD student at the University of Bologna. Please give him a hand. Danilo was instrumental with all the logistics throughout, and he's a great guy, and I hope he'll be inspired to start the company right after this. So without further delay, I think we're ready to field questions from the audience. Do we have anybody, while the remote is thinking, perhaps somebody from here would like to ask a question? Maybe we'll warm up with, Narcis. Narcis, please go ahead.
Nobody remote? Okay. So my question relates to how do we encourage the young researchers to become entrepreneurships or to become or to launch a startup. I think that when we are like me, a young researcher, the skills we don't have are basically two, mainly two. One is that we don't know the distance that there is between the lab prototype and the commercial product. There is a huge distance. It's 10 times that the efforts you've taken to reach the lab prototype, at least. We don't know that. And when you reach that commercial product, probably the technology in which it was based is already obsolete. So you need to continuously invest in research during the life, on the very first years of the company launch. And second, that we don't know, or the skill that we don't have, is that we don't know how a business plan is looks like. Basically, we don't know how to sell that big idea we had in the laboratory when we made research. And my question basically is that in your cases, when you start up with your companies, did you have the both, or did you took the both skills in your teams from the very beginning in your funding team? Meaning, did you had business people or sales people among the founders? Did you have already the support from research people or from the university? I guess that you do, because all of you come from universities. But somehow you need this front line and this back stage at the same time. So I wonder if this is your experience or not.
So I think I'll summarize the question the best I understood, and then we'll take it here. I think Narcis is asking for the first step. you're now willing to try the water. What do you do? And do you make sure that you have business people backing you up right from the beginning? Because you're a technologist, you're a researcher, right? You don't know much about business. So how do you put together the first team? How do you make your first steps and so on? I'll pass on the microphone.
Okay, I'll answer that with one answer, which is, so in both of my startups, I had a co-founder who had taken a company public before. So we did not have sales or business people in the beginning because, again, in the beginning, you have very little money and you want to spend it on developing the technology. That's the most important thing, to get more money. So you don't need to sell anything in the beginning. So you don't need a salesperson. On the business side, the VCs can help you with that. So really what inspires VCs, they're looking for technologists. They're looking for people that can create something new. To them, business people are kind of a dime a dozen, and they have a lot of experience. They're also, you know, business guys. So so if you have a great technology, they can help you, you know, figure out how do we pitch this to the rest of the partners, and that happened in both of my startups. So I think that, and going back to how as a researcher do you take an idea and build it into a product, I mean, I don't even have experimental stuff in my lab. I'm a theorist, right? I don't build stuff. But that's the reason why I build things in companies as opposed to doing it in my research, is that you can hire the right people. I don't know how to build a VLSI chip and lay it out and this and that, but I can find people that can do that. So one of the advantages of having a startup is that you don't need to know how to turn your idea into a product. You can hire the people that can productize the idea. So those challenges you can cover. It's more, what you need to figure out is, do you have a compelling technology that has a market? And you don't necessarily need a business person or a salesperson to help you figure that out.
So indeed, I mean, business sales is not necessarily mandatory at the beginning, but a strategist, so somebody in marketing, understanding the marketing not in terms of communication, maybe at the very early beginning, but understanding the market or the markets are important. So I think that in some cases where you have an ecosystem of startups, you have those like-minded people around you who've created companies, who've been successful, who had failures, etc., who became business angels, VCs, and I think that helps. And certainly, the Silicon Valley is a good example for that, and other areas in the world. But then, when you don't necessarily have that, and it could be also a kind of virtual ecosystem, and this virtual ecosystem is far more difficult to understand and to create, and it's extremely difficult to create but very easy to destroy, and not to comment on the network of excellence and cost actions that are actually the seed for those networks and ecosystems. And I truly believe it. But if you don't have this ecosystem, maybe the European Commission could also, or any kind of that, let's say, funding or catalyst for those transfer of technology from research to companies, they could maybe found the technology transfer in the universities in some regions as well, because those could be also the people not only dealing with the little royalties that could help, that they could get, but really helping identifying locally the right business people or the right markets, or to spend a little bit of money on those market analyses. So.
So, yeah, I would agree that, there is a gap between having a prototype, in a research prototype, and a product. And depending on the technology, this gap can be very big or it can be very small. But then there is a big gap between having this product and selling it. And you will find this after you start a company. Another thing is, I would agree with my colleague also that, and it's at the beginning, it's not so important to sell, but it's very important to know the market. So for example, this is, in our case, this happened at the beginning. So we were very good technologists, very good at technology, at developing technology, at developing in the products that we were doing, but we didn't know enough about the market. And sometimes people who have worked in the market or who come from the market and they know the customers and so on, they can give you a lot of ideas, or they can give you a lot of feedback that sometimes you need if you come from academia only. And the other question was it's basically this. Yeah.
I do agree with all of you. In my understanding, if you found, for instance, if you found a company with your team, the team should be open-minded and should be complementary in some ways. But it's not necessary at all to have a businessman in on board. It's always a good thing, because if someone understands about the market, the time you spend between developing your technology and commercializing it is lower. But you should have at least an idea of how your technology can be used, because the first one that can evaluate the potential value of your technology is the person who has developed it. If you don't have no idea of how your technology can be used, it's hard to think that you will find someone that will find interesting the ideas you're giving to him. Because if you cannot find an application of you cannot find a way for just enhancing the customer experience of anything you can think, it's a very difficult thing that you will succeed with your technology. At least you may think that, and you should be convinced that your technology is gonna give something new, something better to the actual state of art.
One more point I want to make is, I think it's really important to talk to potential customers early on, because you may think, oh, everybody's gonna buy this, but when you talk to someone, like when we talk to Apple, it's like, no, we're never gonna buy this. So you don't need business people or marketing people if you can get in the door of potential customers, but I think validating that there are potential customers out there that would buy what you're building is really important very early on.
So I guess I could summarize the opinions here, which I totally agree with pretty much everything. And I think the first thing that researchers ought to understand is that they're sitting on some very powerful stuff themselves. Knowing a field well and understanding your field is more powerful than you think. It's very, very important to know your thing. And most of the people here and in the research community know their field. So there needs to be a dose of self-confidence, I think, that you're already possessing the more important aspect of the equation, which is knowing something that others don't. And you don't necessarily, I think what I heard, and I agree, you don't necessarily have to have the business plan down pat from the beginning. You have to have, however, a clear idea of why you want to do that and who's going to buy it. Sometimes, you know, it looks hard, like, you know, I have an idea, but who's going to buy it? And sometimes customers come to you. They have a pain, as they call it. Some people need something. There's two ways to start something, right? Either you start something, hope that people will buy it because you think it's good, or there's a pool, a customer pool, people come to you, or they come to your ecosystem. And the second more important thing is you're never alone, really. You don't start something and then hope for the best. You're in an ecosystem. You know companies. You know people. People know you. Venture capitalists come to you. It's really much more networked. It's a much more networked activity than it looks from afar. So it's easier in some ways. That's what I'm trying to say. All right.
I have one question, actually, an open question to all. Not on technology, though. But on venture capital firms, which are often needed in the launch or consolidation of startups. So the question is, I would like to know, I'm curious to know, about your experience in working with venture capital firms. I mean, lessons learned,
best things, worst things, what it takes to work with them, just from your experience. Thank you.
I add something to this, because in my own experience, from what I see, for instance, where I work, it's relatively easy to come up with a group of 10, 20 people, this also happened to me, with a good idea, with some initial customer, you go and establish the company, you do this, and then what? The main problem that I see is that these startup companies, we have an incubator in Pisa, stay small. They come to a certain size, 10 people, 20 people, but then where are the opportunities to grow, to get a real... Andrea, you said that you raised 120 million. That's for European standards, Italian standards. It's amazing. In Italy, you should have been done immediately Cavaliere del Lavoro in front of the President of the Republic, or even 20 million is still amazing. And so the problem that I see that is related perhaps to what you say, Carlos, is how can we find the equivalent in Europe of venture capitalists in the United States? Perhaps is there a recipe? What is your story? How did you manage to get to a critical mass of the company?
Okay, so I think that's a pretty important question. I just want to point out, though, that I think at least two here, I would think Mark, same as me, are bootstrapped. It's not always necessary to secure venture capital early on. Charlie Square, by the way, never had any funding. It's privately owned, bootstrapped itself all the way, doesn't owe any dime to anybody. Let's say something about the founders. Huh? So it's not a one-way street. However, I'll probably have to agree that to hit large-scale mass markets and so on, you need to raise some funding. So I'm not the right person to talk about it because we haven't gotten any funding, but I'll yield to the people who have.
Well, the first one that I would like to address is this question regarding the difference, well, also our experience with VCs, but also the difference between the VCs in Europe and the VCs in the US, for example. And, well, I can talk about the difference between the VCs in Spain and the VCs in the US, and the differences are amazing. So, I mean, to raise this amount of money in Spain is really difficult. So you have to, at the end, you have to go to the UK or to the US. So this is... But you can do it. I mean, if you have a good technology, even in Spain, you can go to look for a US investor or for a UK investor or a German investor. So you can do this. They may ask you to move the company to the US, but it's this is another thing. but then you do it. I mean, you start. So you set the company in Delaware, and that's all. Is it necessary? I think this depends on the nature of the company. So some companies can be funded by a customer, for example, if the customer wants the product, because the product is very differential and they want to take the technical risk of putting money on this. Or maybe you don't need a lot of money to develop your technology, or maybe you can do it with public funding, but usually in technological companies, you need money, and for this, you need either public or VCs.
I fully agree with Mark's view. In fact, depending on the nature of your business, it's a must. In fact, if you want to scale, to really scale in your business, you need some kind of VC. In fact, at least in Spain, the kind of culture that have the VCs you can find is the kind of culture you can find in banks. They are just lending money without giving any kind of additional support. So it's more or less the same that going to a bank and trying to ask for some money, because they are not VCs in the same way that this word is understood in the United States. In the States, you can go for a person or for a firm that can just put a huge amount of money in order to bet if the boat just arrives to America. Let's say it's like saying to Cristobal Colón, "Hi, I'm giving you the money. I don't know what will happen, but if it works, it will work globally, not only if your country. So you're not a local entrepreneur. You're a world-class entrepreneur. So that's a huge difference in the culture and the way that people understand the businesses. In fact, for some technologies, just working with operators, for instance, is a completely mess, because you must spend, for instance, years of technology validation. If you're not one of the classical vendors, you must try to convince people that you're fulfilling all the quality requirements they're trying to push. And this means wasting tons of money. So here in Europe, you can go for just public grants in order to cope with the needs of financing, of financement you have. You can have some paying customers. This is obviously the best way for running a company, but because you are not laying on having to return some money. But the reality is that at the end of the day, you will need some VC money, and it's really hard to find European firms that can have the understanding for the technologies, or for just disruptive technologies you can find in the States, mostly in the Boston area or the Bay Area.
One thing I would like to add also is that if you go to look for VCs, then you must know that they are professional investors. So, and they put money in your company and they want to sell the company, either to another acquirer or to the stock market, but they want to sell the company. So this is really important, because sometimes you know people from academia who say, yeah, I want to start a company and I want to work in this company forever. Well, this might not be the case if you have VCs. So they want to sell the company as soon as possible, and with the highest multiplier, of course.
Yeah, I'll make one quick comment, because obviously I'm coming from a different perspective. So I would say if you can self-fund a company, you should. I mean, it's absolutely better. You retain control. You retain all the stock. But for many companies, especially a chip company, you can't. I mean, there's no way you can build a chip company. Now, of the 180 million, 70 million came from the Russian mafia, effectively laundered through a Russian VC. And that's because Sequoia, we had a fantastic partner at Sequoia, Mike Gogan, who gave us the seed money for our very first round. He came in on every funding round. He brought in all our other investors, and he was a really wise, valuable person in the company. So I had a very positive experience having such a well-known VC firm and person involved in the company. It was very positive. It was worth the equity that we gave up to Sequoia. In the second company, we had a very hard time raising money. The VC firm that funded us was in turmoil. They did not come in on every round. We were starved of cash, and it created all kinds of problems. We might have actually been able to bootstrap that company. I'm not sure about that. We wanted to go faster, and that's why we took money, but I'm not sure that was the right thing to do. So I think that VCs can be very valuable. They're essential in certain types of companies. And by the way, raising $180 million is no piece of cake. And I think, again, today it would be probably a lot harder to fund even $10 million for a chip company than it was in 2005 when we were first raising money for Quantenna.
Okay, thank you very much for the questions. Is there another one question right now? Because what I'd like to do is there one? I can entertain one more at most. I'd like to. Is there one? Yeah, let's go on. I don't see any. So what I'd like to do right now is close by doing the following. There is a in NEWCOM, there is a great university, EuroCom, and a great partner, Raymond Knopp, with Florian Kaldenberger. And they have developed, they have contributed, as you know, a platform. They've developed it over many years. It's they will describe it more. And they think that this could be an enabler for people who would like to start small companies. So this is a somewhat different twist from the panel. We'll talk about, so they will give us a presentation, a short one basically, and I think Raymond, I assume that Raymond is there now online, he can do it, no? He said yes.
I'll try and do it if you can hear me.
Is he?
Yes.
Great. So you have the floor. You can get the presentation itself.
I have to share my screen. They have to give me the ball. Can they pass over the ball to For some reason, the audio's gone now.
I just want to say we can hear you fine, Raymond. We see the slides and we can hear you fine.
Now I can hear you again. So I guess you should be seeing my screen now. But unfortunately, the audio is gone again.
We do, yeah.
So now I hear you again.
Raymond, can you see us? Like
I can see. I'm sharing my screen, so I can't see. I can't see the room anymore. No, I can hear you now.
But the problem is, like, we only have you on audio due to our streaming setup. So you will talk and I will pass the slides, I guess.
Well, you don't see my slides anymore?
I don't. Like, do you see our end, our screen?
No, I don't. I'm sharing my screen. I can turn mine off again.
So they're telling me that you should stop sharing video.
Okay.
And only share audio. And you should be seeing, like, what we are streaming. Yes, I mean the alternative is have Florian directly give the presentation.
Okay, maybe it's better because I mean I don't see what's happening here.
So like if you can see anything, it's a problem.
Because the ball is still on my on me, so maybe you should put the ball back on yours and then.
Raymond, we have your slides here already. They're on the screen. You just need to walk us through them.
Yeah, but the ball is not on.
You don't care about the ball.
Well, I can't see the screen anymore. So. I did, but I don't see it anymore.
The slides are here. We see them on this. You want to do it, Raymond, or shall I do it?
Well, I can do it. I mean, as long as you tell me what slide you're on.
Number one.
Okay. So I'll start and please interrupt me if you stop hearing me.
Okay.
So as Andreas said, I'm going to give a little bit of a different presentation. I'm not presenting here a startup, not even really a startup idea, but more about what we've created to not only enable startups, but that is one of the objectives.
Sure. Yeah, I know about it. Go ahead.
All right, so first, just a little bit of background where we're coming from. Open Air Interface is something that started out of NEWCOM's research activities around 10 years ago. It's evolved, and it's really something to experiment with cellular radio technologies. Right? So we've always been a group that's been working with 3GPP technologies. What we see happening now in the world of 3GPP is it's coming dangerously close to the open source world. And that's something we've been doing for a long time. So what we're trying to do with our activity now is propose the open source route for 5G. And I think it's starting to catch on very, very quickly. And I'll try and make that that point on two slides. The first thing that we see happening is, and this is a sentence that I got from interactions on our mailing list with a fairly senior architect at Cisco in California. His opinion is that the economics of the of mobile area are changing towards what we could call a commoditization of the radio access networks. Now, why do we say that? Well, what we see is happening on the extremities of the radio access networks, so in the so-called the cloud computing area, you see emerging concepts like software-defined networking or network function virtualization, and you see communities, which are a combination of academics and major industry, putting together consortiums, open source consortiums like the OPNFV consortium. You see OpenStack, that is the de facto standard for cloud computing today and virtualization technologies. Companies like Ubuntu, which deliver the different versions of the one of the versions of the Linux operating system, they propose this OpenStack framework for cloud computing. And what's happening really is that OpenStack is getting very close to the radio access networks. So base stations are not running in OpenStack today, except some experimental base stations, but it's getting very close. And the other thing that's happening is there's lots of cheap open source hardware that's starting to emerge also. Right? Today you can buy 3G, 4G quality hardware from companies that are actually giving away the schematics of their boards. Another thing happening is that there's more generic computing equipment that goes right down to the physical layer. So when I say generic, I mean that are running classical processors like Intel-based processors or even ARM-based processors. And this is even starting to include the physical layer. Right? You see projects like OpenBTS or our own Open Air Interface. These are fairly simple, but there are more complicated ones as well. And finally, the last thing that you see, and I saw this at the last Mobile World Congress, is companies like Canonical. This is the company that provides the Ubuntu operating system and their OpenStack packages. They provide orchestration and operating system solutions, which are at least good for prototyping today for the core network of a cellular system. That was astounding for me to see that at the Mobile World Congress, because you don't think about companies like Canonical putting together software for cellular networks, but they do now. So just as an example, what you could actually do is you can take our software and you have a full experimental LTE release 10 eNodeB and the core network as well. And even to a certain extent, we could run our software operating as a terminal. Right? So we're actually in a position to do a demonstration at the next Mobile World Congress of a full LTE network with voice over LTE. So that's something that most networks, except perhaps in the United States, are not really using yet. Right? And this could be open source end to end, including the core network, existing software from Clearwater for the IMS core, and software that does the policy control, which allows you to actually do voice over an LTE network, the so-called PCRF functions. And so all of these things are existing in open source, and you could essentially build a 4G network in open source using Ubuntu's framework, which is actually quite remarkable. The other interesting thing, and I won't do all of this slide, that we see happening is there's an emergence of an enormous number of hackers in radio networks. Today, you find people that are using GNU Radio, but not only GNU Radio, all of these people that are working with Yates BTS, with OsmoCom, with other types of solutions for 3G as well. These are basically hackers that are putting together mock cellular networks. And finally, some of the hardware that you can buy is basically computing equipment that you can get at the supermarket to build a base station, with a bit of help from companies like National Instruments or Line Microsystems that make easily accessible RF equipment. So that is a very, very powerful combination when you start to put cheap hardware together with hackers and open source. I mean, it's something that could make big equipment vendors a bit afraid. In fact, I think it's a message to equipment vendors that they better start looking at open source more carefully. All right, so I'll skip the rest because it's not absolutely necessary here. So with all of this, what did we realize? We realized it was time to actually do an alliance of people that wanted to work on open source for cellular systems. Today we have something which is 4G, but what we'd like to do is follow the standardization now with a community, maybe of hundreds of developers all over the world, in order to follow what 3GPP is doing towards 5G, and at the same time that they come out with a frozen standard, we have a reference implementation running on generic hardware in open source. That is the objective. In order to do this, we need contributors that are coming outside of our group, and I would say in the last year, we've gotten some fairly serious contributors from all over the place. It started off in Asia, but now we have a lot that are coming from Europe, and very quickly North America is primarily the United States, are starting to help us do this from all over the place. And we launched this so-called Open Air Interface Software Alliance at the end of 2014. It's a little bit like a foundation in the United States. The objective is to put together different types of people that want to develop with us. So the thing that we've created here is not at all a startup. It's not a single startup, but it's really a creation of something more complicated than that, of really creating an ecosystem so that we can do distributed development of our software. And what this could actually result in is potentially many startups and small companies mutualizing the core software and building their own proprietary solutions around it and on top of it. So this is really in the spirit of OpenStack or some other movements like Eclipse or the Linux Foundation, but for 3GPP-based standardized systems. That's the catch here. And that's actually the hard part. So I'll skip some of the other bullets here, but what we're looking for is a much more global adoption for innovation and research. We want vendors' labs, university labs to work together to have a common tool between industrial and academic research. That is really the objective. I can say happily that we have, as of this afternoon, an official yes from Akatalus and Bell Labs. So they are agreeing to work in an open source framework with us on this to develop the software towards 5G. This is really fresh this afternoon. We see a lot of potential business adoption in a test and prototyping market. Many of the companies that are realizing what we're doing are coming from the testing market. And finally, we also see this as a launchpad for SMEs and startup companies, and I'll have one final slide on that after. I can just say this very quickly. These are the strategic areas that the Alliance is working on. Right at the top, we can call it softwarization of networks. That's really everything having to do with merging the world of cloud computing with the radio access. So you can talk about Cloud RAN or mobile edge computing, that sort of thing. We do have a lot of interest in prototyping 5G modem, primarily for below 6 gigahertz systems. At the bottom, test and measurement, as I said, that's one of the main areas driving this. And also, we are having a lot of interest in people wanting to innovate, find a quick path to making devices for Internet of Things. And that's another area. For instance, Cisco was primarily interested in what we're doing because of that. So one of the important things, and I'm assuming that you're looking at the licensing slide here.
Yes.
Yes, okay. Is that when you're working with open source software, there, even though it's to a certain extent intellectual property is protected, people that are actually proposing implementations of patents that they have, they relinquish the rights to their patents. So that is one of the hurdles in getting software that is implementing 3GPP type standards out there by people that are actually developing the standard. They can't really contribute. So what we have in Open Air Interface now is a dual licensing model. So the code is split into two pieces. One piece on the left-hand side, which you can see is called the OAI public license, that has two pieces. It has the implementation of the terminals and the implementations of the base stations. That is under a special license that protects the intellectual property of major companies that are providing input to the implementation. So for instance, a company like Alcatel-Lucent that wants to put in an implementation of their new waveform that they will propose in 3GPP and for 5G, they won't lose rights to royalties on that with this type of a license. Had they done that with another open source license, they would lose their rights to royalties. So we have a piece of this, the software for the access networks, which is covered by that license, and the core network implementation, which is really the operator's core network, that is under a standard Apache V2 license. And so that's a very common licensing scheme. For instance, all of OpenStack is done under that license. So this is actually a very, very challenging part to come up with the licensing scheme so that we can have companies trying to use this in such a way that it can help their business without losing money on intellectual property. So I just wanted to mention that quickly. So finally, this is my last slide, how SMEs can actually benefit from this development. Number one is that they would have a low-cost access to 3GPP technologies. Okay, that's number one. Number two, they can leverage a community of developers. That's a very, very, very powerful thing. If we say that this is why Linux is as powerful as it is, that's why companies like Google jumped on the Linux operating system to develop Android. It's because there is a community of developers out there that they don't have to employ themselves. And this SMEs can really benefit from that. If they play the open source game right, they can benefit from it. The other benefit of joining an alliance like this is the ability to participate in projects that are run by the alliance in conjunction with its strategic partners. So for instance, in Open Air Interface, we target 10 strategic partners. It looks like we're going to have 6 right from the start. That are paying, they pay money to help maintain the software by the core developers, but they actually are interested in doing this to run projects with people in the community. That's the way these open source ecosystems work. Right, so small companies can get to work in projects with big companies and leverage a community to get their technology implemented quicker, so they can actually concentrate on the stuff that is coming from, they don't have to implement the stuff that's coming from the community, and they can implement around it. They can contribute to the community, but they don't have to implement all of it. So one example, and this is one that's running right now, I won't name all the names, I'll name a couple of the names. This is the case of how an existing SME can make use of the alliance. So for instance, we have a big terminal vendor. In this case, it's Alcatel OneTouch, which is number 4 or number 5, I think, in the world. It's a company called TCL from China. They want to have a 5G prototyping platform for demonstrating enhanced UE features. So basically, they don't want to build a commercial-grade UE. They want to quickly build a prototype so that they can demonstrate the new features to their future clients. And an SME wants to sell services and proprietary implementations in the form of an LTEM prototyping platform. So LTEM is the variant of LTE that 3GPP is now proposing for Internet of Things. And so these implementations build upon an existing UE platform or existing terminal platform from Open Air Interface, and now extend it in the directions that these companies want. Now you can also imagine a semiconductor company that wants to experiment with LTEM on their silicon, for instance, Intel. And so you have two very big companies and a small SME that are working together on an open source implementation where the core is open source, and they each build their own proprietary implementations on top of it to demonstrate what they want to demonstrate. And all of them collaborate in the context of a project and inject the needed development into the ecosystem. And that's a little bit the way these OpenStacks and other types of ecosystems work. Now, for the SME, it gains valuable exposure to major companies, which could become future clients, and they also get software that can be used on top of Open Air Interface in its service offering. And so it's a win-win for everybody in this example. Another example that I can give in the last one would be a hypothetical new startup company. So you could imagine a new SME that wants to develop an enhanced remote radiohead technology and baseband unit software for cloud RAN systems. Right? So this is what's in fashion right now. In the United States, there's a very big company called Altiostar Networks, which is a spin-off of a company that was bought by Cisco, and they're funded heavily by Cisco. That's essentially what they want to do on generic computing equipment, but in a closed fashion. So imagine now we wanted to have a company that would be developing that kind of equipment on top of Open Air Interface. They partner, say, with a tier one vendor like Alcatel-Lucent and a server or silicon vendor like Intel through the alliance. The SME is going to develop new low-cost remote radio heads, which are provided in the end to Alcatel-Lucent, and also special baseband unit software that can run on an Intel architecture-based cloud RAN solution. And then the vendor is very happy because it gets some innovative technology that it could use to deploy the cloud RAN in China. Right, so this is one example. I mean, it's completely hypothetical, but it's one example. And what's interesting out of this is that the core software is completely open source. You get it from the Alliance, just like OpenStack. And the specific software for this kind of application remains property of the SME, with licensing agreements to Intel and the vendor in question. And so this would be one type of activity. And we could dream up lots of these. And that's why I say this kind of an instrument, or the alliance that we've created, is something that could fuel many SMEs. There's lots of potential out there, and we're trying to find these companies, and a lot of them are actually finding us very quickly and proposing these kind of things to us. And so I think that's really all I wanted to present here. And to a certain extent, some of this came out of a lot of the thought that went into what we were proposing in the context of the Network of Excellence in EUIN. A lot of the thought came out of there. And I think this is one very nice outcome of NEWCOM to a certain extent.
Super.
This was Raymond Knopp. I assume. Thank you very much, Raymond. I find it.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yeah, I find it extremely interesting because I connected to Andreas' comment that if you want to do hardware, kind of forget it. There's no way to break in. It's cost demanding and so forth. Maybe that is a soft way of getting in and getting your ideas. That's a very, very interesting intermediate step, actually. Answers the question how to start, Maybe there's a way, a soft way. Is there any question for Raymond before we wrap it up for tonight? Well, I'd like to thank you again. Thank you very much for coming. I'd like to thank the panel one more time. And close it on a high note. Thank you so very much.